Once again, here are 10 things about Godot we wish we knew earlier. Don't tell the other ones, but this one is the best one yet. Keeping your scenes well arranged is essential in order to be productive. But once you have a few collision shapes, things get messy quickly. Which brings us to number one. You can color them. First, change their base color to white instead of that blue. For this, go to the project settings and search for shape. We can now simply use the modulate of the collision shape node to color them however we want. Maybe red for hitboxes, blue for hurt boxes, and green for trigger zones. By the way, the input event, mouse entered and mouse exited signals are only emitted when the area is visible. So in case you want the area to be invisible, do not hide the area, but instead modulate it transparent.
Sometimes you have to restart your project, and you can do this really quick with trick number two. Go to Project, Reload Current Project, and boom, world record speedrun. For the Reopen All Tabs category, you have another strategy. Go to the editor settings and enable the setting Restore Scenes on Load. It might take a bit longer to start up, but it's so worth it.
Have you ever found yourself using a construction like this? There's a great alternative to that. Number three. You can deactivate process as well as physics process with set process false and set physics process false, and just reactivate them when they should compute. This can be a bit more readable at times and is a bit more performant, but keep in mind that you cannot directly see whether the process is activated, so think about when to do it. And don't forget, physics process works in fixed steps and is great for everything that needs that. Process is run every time you display a frame, which makes it preferable when you change something that is purely visual.
Number 4. The in keyword does more than you think. We can use it to check if a value is in an array. We also can check if a string is in another string, or if a key-value pair exists in a dictionary. The obvious application is in a typical for loop. Fun fact, you can just write for I in 12. But there's more we can do with this. We can replace the range with an array of our choice. This is quite convenient to enumerate some numbers. We can also use it to iterate a string character-wise. Oh, by the way, there's also an is operator. It is amazing to check for types and subtypes. We can use it to find the type of an untyped argument. This is especially useful when you have custom types that have a class name and type hierarchy.
Number 5. If you ever want a player to be inside a collider, you can make it hollow. Collision polygons have a build mode property. This is solid by default, but when you change it to segments, only the outline is a collider and other collision objects can be inside of it.
If you don't want the collisions to be always on, you can disable them. There are different options. Number 6. How to disable collisions. You can set the collision shape to disabled, but when you do this, you should use set deferred. When we were young and adventurous, we thought, what is the worst thing that could happen? The game can crash, actually. You could also take away all collision layers. If working with an area, we usually set the monitorable and monitoring flag to false. This should also be done with set deferred. Using these flags, you can precisely control whether the area can be detected and whether it can detect other collision objects.
Sometimes, when you are animating something, you can save half of the work by playing an animation backwards. Number 7. You can use play backwards for that, or use play with a negative animation speed. Keep in mind that you also have to set from end to true in order to make it work.
Number 8. Match operator. Match is basically the switch statement in other languages, but more powerful than usual. The syntax is pretty simple. Write match and the variable or expression you want to check, then indented, the pattern, a colon, and then the code block you want to execute if the pattern is matched. You can match integers and strings. You can also match types. Bind the result to a variable, do pattern matching on an array, do pattern matching on a dictionary, or mix all of that.
Number 9. How to use translations. Translations are very convenient, but I found them a little tricky to set up. So here is how to do it. Use a CSV that is UTF-8 encoded. Make the first column named keys. The others must be named like a valid locale from this list. If you set this up right, Godot will automatically generate these translation files, which you need to import separately, not the CSV, these files. Go to Project Settings, Localization and add them. Now you can write tr and give it a key, which returns the text for the current locale. You can change this locale with translation server set locale. If you want to implement some nice features, you might want to access the keys. You can do it with get message list. This simply does not work for optimized translations, however. You can use an unoptimized one and optimize it later, just leave it at that or include a CSV and parse that. To use an unoptimized localization, go to the import settings of the CSV and uncheck compress.
When working with particle systems, you can set their scale even with a curve, which is so great. But sometimes it would be so nice to squeeze them in a single direction. And this can be done with trick number 10. You can access their scale with a vertex shader. Just attach it to a particle system and add the vertex function. You can now transform the four vertices separately. You could even make shearing. If you want to make it lifetime dependent, you can read that from instance custom Y. So have fun squeezing your particles, but be gentle. Let us know your tips and tricks so we can feature them in future videos.